hold your head up. It's casi estás beginning. The time is now, today. Gusto bang nandin, the feeling's getting stronger. The world is yours to play.
Welcome and Sunday Bonani. This once again is the 100% talk show. You know what it is. This is the show that always gives you 100% talk for 100% real people. And that is you. You are the real people, Etequini. Thank you so much for joining us once again for this episode. We are so excited to have you here. And we're so excited to have this conversation today. I hope you're going to enjoy it as much as I'm sure we will as well. So thank you so much for your comments, your likes, your shares, your subscribe on social media. Nothing goes unnoticed. And we thank you so much for that. I would love to give a huge thanks to New Confidence Designs, the lady that makes me look absolutely amazing each and every single time we shoot. I would also like to thank Isimo Deni Creations for their amazing accessories that really just complete and complement the outfit. And of course, Musgrave Center for hosting us once again. Thank you so very much. It is always, always, always such an honor to be hosted by you. So thank you very much to Musgrave Center. So I would like to introduce today's guest. Now, as you would know, the topic is the role of the church in time of pandemic. This should be really interesting. I am sitting here with Mr. Andile Mafa, Mr. Lidoko, who couldn't join us today, so that we may know that in this time that we're in this time of crisis, in this time of pandemic, what has been, what is, and what can be in future the role of the church. So without further ado, Mr. Andile Mafa, how are you?
Thank you. How are you?
I'm very good. I'm very good.
Awesome.
Yeah, so thank you so much for coming on today. Anyway, about you. Who are you, Mr. Andile Mafa? Who is this handsome gentleman that is sitting in front of us? Yeah.
Well, yeah, like you said, my name is Andile Mafa. My friends call me Wa. Those who know me for a short while, they call me Mafa, I think. From Mlazi, I'm married to Nomzamo. Mm-hmm. My wife, Happiness, and we just had a baby. So I have two kids, Usbahle, who's very old, and Unathi, who's probably...
And it makes you what? If she's very old, then you are...
I'm okay. Okay. Very, very young.
You're very young.
Very, very young. I used to be a cost accountant, yeah. Actually, sometime back in my other life. Along the way, I was aware that God had another intention for my life. So around that time, when God was kind of nudging the idea that the time of being an accountant and all that is kind of up. Listened to God and wrapped up that life and moved into what we may call today, or what church normally thinks of as a Nehemiah kind of engagement,
okay,
with communities.
Explain that to us.
Where most of the time when people think they're called by God, they think they're called to start a church. Well, for me, it was very clear that it wasn't to start essentially a church, but it was to engage, to be in a space where church can engage communities.
And so when you heard, okay, thank you very much, Mr. Baba, for introducing yourself. So when you heard of this topic, okay, church, what is the role of the church in time of pandemic or in time of crisis? What was the first thing that just came into your mind?
Right now, there's a very big battle of definition what the church is.
Yeah.
Big definition. That's the first thing that came to my mind, that, wow, there are many opinions of what church is. Yeah. So that's the first thing I had to wrestle with in my own heart, to say, what is church?
Hmm.
And also, when somebody has a role, it means they are visible, they have a contribution to make, and they're essentially not trying to prove a point. This is who they are.
Hmm.
That means role has to do with expressing your identity. For me, church is very simple.
Yeah.
I became part of church because I got saved. I accepted Jesus Christ, mm-hmm, as the Lord and Savior in my life. By that, I became part of church. So another thing that is big about church is that church is people. It's not an organization. It's people. I'm church, you know? And so when we're talking about the role of church, we're talking about what is Andile's role?
Right.
What is another born-again believer's role? Or as a collective, what is our role as people? Because sometimes whenever we think of church, we think of our Sunday fellowships. We think of the meeting logistics that we have on Sundays. And what we do there.
And so before we delve into COVID-19 specifically, right? So I would imagine, or I would have thought that church would have gone through times of pandemic, through times of destabilization, through times of whatever kind of hardships,
sure,
before, right? So what are some of the blueprint elements that we can take from the church of old, right?
Sure.
That we can probably now look into ourselves and think, can we not probably employ some of those?
Probably the first thing we must establish first is that for church, it shouldn't be a surprise when we go through an epidemic. It shouldn't be. because Jesus in Matthew 24 kind of lays it out that in the last days, there's going to be some hectic times. There's going to be pestilences, famine. So for us, when we go through such a hard time, it should be, well, the Lord has spoken about these realities. So that's one of the issues that church should not be startled, but it should be, there is a prophetic reality that we've been informed of that possibly will happen at some point in future. Number two, for me, I would like us to characterize an epidemic so we can actually understand that there could be different times that the church has gone through a hard time or an epidemic kind of time. So an epidemic is usually characterized by limitation of what you are used to. Mm-hmm. That's number one. Basically, you lose your normalcy. So that's one thing. Number two, economy or your livelihood is affected. An epidemic affects livelihood. People die during an epidemic. You know, basically people also migrate during an epidemic because they're trying to figure out a new way of life. And if we go back to scripture, you'll find numerous times in the New Testament where the church, we can even start with the churches in the book of Acts, that there was a famine at some point in Jerusalem and also a persecution of the church. So that for church was persecution meant what? Loss of livelihood. Because sometimes whatever resource they had, if you are persecuted, you will run. When you run, you leave your business, you leave your stuff. And also you lose friendship connection. But no, you're on the run and all that. So there are moments in the church that have been characterized by the same thing we're experiencing. And the question is, how did those believers then respond when that happened?
Right.
So when we look at the book of Acts, one of the things that is amazing for me when believers respond to an epidemic is the fact that an individual believer becomes prominent. Mm. You know, when church is normal, mm-hmm. not in a bad way, leaders are the most prominent figures in the church.
Yeah.
But when an epidemic strike in the book of Acts, when they were persecuted, when there was famine, you begin to see individual believers beginning to really be functional. Individual believer planting churches. Individual believer preaching the gospel, which earlier in the book of Acts, we're not really hearing much of their activity, but we're beginning to hear of them in Antioch. We begin to hear of them in Ephesus. We begin to hear them in different places where the apostles didn't actually start church communities. Believers did.
Right, right. You and know. So, I mean, speaking of that, having even in the Church of Acts, individual believers mm-hmm. sort of rising up and, you know, taking charge. Let's bring it back now to this pandemic that we're currently facing, right? Mm-hmm. COVID-19.
Sure.
There was a lot of confusion. I mean, understandably so.
Yes.
A lot of confusion, a lot of panic, you know, a lot of different things that aren't exactly what you're saying,
sure.
right, with regards to the church of old. What do you think is probably missing in the church in the sense of an individual believer right now in 2021,
yeah, sure.
that we probably couldn't rise up as that church did in that time of pandemic?
Well, we're still going to see if we did or not. Usually
okay.
how church behaved in an epidemic is seen during the prominent time of the epidemic as if it's confusing, but
right.
usually you see the fruit afterwards. But one of the things that has been the issue, that has been a big issue for me, is shepherding. That because we can't attend Sunday morning, it became as if shepherding has been cut off.
Mm.
God, one of the things that church leaders or church is about human development,
right.
is about shepherding. And I'm talking about shepherding holistically, meaning you're not just dealing with the fact that the person needs to be spiritually okay. They need to be engaging their environment in a very sound way,
mm-hmm.
meaning the way they engage news, the way they engage the epidemic itself, the way they engage different information that comes through that process. You will find that I don't believe churches behave sound in that. I don't believe, in a sense, sometimes you even feel like us who are leaders or shepherds have neglected to holistically shepherd their flock.
Mm.
To say, I am going to actually work diligently as a leader to actually shepherd my church.
Mm.
And number two, I am going to find systems or ways. The interesting thing about the church of old when they were dealing with an epidemic is that they began to write letters. I mean, Jesus didn't write a letter. Did you know that? But Paul did. Peter did. So this church, when they began to go under crisis, they began to engage the technology of the time
right.
to shepherd the believers.
Right.
And even here, letters writing about very personal issues in the church that was existing at that time, meaning shepherding was holistic.
Mm-hmm.
Paul even talks about those guys who don't want to work. He says, those who don't work mustn't eat. You understand how detailed what shepherding was?
Yeah.
So the church, I believe at this time, as much as we rose and did Facebook and all that, but it didn't really rise to really shepherding people to the way we should have. That's one of the issues. And in then dealing with fake news, in then dealing with the noises. So the shepherding element is a big element for church in the time of crisis.
Sure.
That we cannot meet doesn't mean as a shepherd, I mustn't shepherd.
Hmm.
So that's a very big issue, meaning as a shepherd, diligently engage technology, diligently orientate your believers around this new phenomenon. Meaning part of shepherding now is orientating my believers around how to engage technology. As I would have put ushers in a church on how to sit, how to do things, I orientate people on that. Now I have to orientate them on how to engage that thing. So that's a very big thing. You even hear Paul, when he writes these letters, he says, when you finish reading the letter, give it to others and take the one that others have got to you. He was orientating them on how to engage the new shepherding system he had put in place.
So you mean there's some kind of, probably information hierarchy that needs to happen where the shepherd needs to always be ahead, you know, needs to constantly be ahead in order to be able to feed sheep.
That's right how person. It is. If you're shepherding people, actually, leaders in the church, they know definitely that's how it ought to be. Meaning if I have to actually begin to resource myself with understanding epidemiology, I must do that so that my believers are not susceptible to fake news, wrong information. So the frustrations that we may feel, I'm not taking them lightly, because this has to do with livelihood. But it doesn't mean then let's neglect the thing that Jesus is going to ask you about.
Right.
Because that's another issue.
Yeah.
Jesus is not going to ask about the excuses you may have of not doing what you need to do during the time of the pandemic. He's going to really ask you, did you love my sheep? Did you do this? Did you do this?
Sure.
Did you do this? You may even have a valid explanation, but it will actually be charged.
Yeah.
According to the law, you know?
Yeah. And so that difference of, I would say, ability or probably even information or knowledge, do you think maybe that's what led, or one of the things that sort of incorporated in the frustration to reopen, you know, church? Because now there's no, I don't have anything else to give to my sheep, probably as a shepherd, outside of just us meeting or, you know?
That's a very controversial statement.
It is. I'm picking your brain on
around the issue of reopening.
You know?
According to me, really, church never closed. This is, as I said, it's controversial.
Elaborate.
Churches never closed. Yes, meetings were closed, but shepherding never stopped.
Mm.
Our lives in Christ have never stopped. And we need to kind of begin to speak about the real thing here. The issue is not the meeting. When we talk about church, the meetings are very important. The Bible tells us not to neglect fellowship, but there are other ways of fellowshipping today. But in terms of church itself and what ought to do, it was a demand for evolution for church. How do we evolve? How do I evolve as a shepherd into ministering to that believer and that? I think sometimes usually, how do I, instead of renting a venue, how do I then now begin to make data available for my believers to engage my platform?
And so I think maybe let's move in sort of into our topic. I know we've mentioned a lot of, of things in a lot of ways, but maybe just to have a more streamlined outline of how can the church, what is the role of the church in time of pandemic?
That's a mouthful that you asked us.
Yeah. I know.
People in the church are called by God to different functionalities.
Right.
So can we first respect that?
When you say functionalities, you mean?
Essentially, I'm meaning someone can be called to actually be a pastor who pastors a church, and he has to primary responsibility is to actually feed his sheep and make sure that they are spiritually healthy. And essentially, and you find that the demarcation of God's scope for his life is that don't go beyond this. This is what I want you to actually focus on. Meaning, when we talk about our role during the epidemic, it doesn't actually activate us to some good idea emotion. It has to also be within the scope of what God has called you to actually engage. Number two, there is the issue of church beginning to express its nature and love for itself in terms of me loving my brothers and my sisters. And also the church loving the people that it exists within that is called to minister to. So again, even there, you want to be directed by God, but also you want to be present. I think one of the things that church's role in an epidemic must be is, can I be present in the midst of people suffering? But at the same time, another thing that church has to kind of consider, church has to become a leader in the time of epidemic. Meaning what our role as a speaker, as people who are prophetic, as people who are able to reorientate spaces. We cannot just focus on good works, which are good, and forget our primary role, which is proclaiming truth at any point in time, particularly when communities are in crisis. We need to bring definition what this is. We need to actually get the ear of communities in one way or another in terms of directing them what to do. Meaning, one way or another, must find a way to actually shepherd communities. So church in an epidemic must engage the opportunities that God has created in that time. So
basically the pandemic is an opportunity
right. for church. Right. Because we know things like this will happen. So essentially, one of the things that is unique about us as church is that God has prepared us for this.
Right.
Either we know or not, there is a capacity that we have as church to respond. Or our propheticness is no use.
Right.
Most of the time, this epidemic has been politicized. This epidemic has been used as leverage in different ways.
Right.
But church has the sincerity of just being clearly truthful about issues without having any other motive except to deliver truth about issues, about situations, about things.
Sure.
Which also means church must actually be more purified.
That's exactly what I'm thinking, dude. I'm actually thinking, do you think maybe things like politics has really shaped church in a certain kind of way? Things like differing worldviews, things like whatever it is that is not, I use very lightly pure. You know, I use the word very lightly.
Look, that is not something we can avoid. These are blowing winds, or what the book of Esther calls is winds of doctrines.
Right.
There will be perspectives. There will be many perspectives. Hence, we must engage warfare during this time. It's time to really be strong enough to actually express kingdom view about issues and be bold about it. Be courageous about it. This is the kingdom God's perspective of navigating a time like this. Because you don't want to mix what you are doing as church with controversy. You still want to be...
It can get quite controversial.
It can. So you want to be wise. You want to pick your battles. You want to know that this is a battle that cannot be really primal in the time where we're trying to minister, become proximate. So you have to choose battles carefully. You have to choose things you go for carefully. Because remember, at the end of the day as church, we're not trying to prove a point that we are right. We're trying to minister and save lives. And like I said, churches are believers. This is where every believer is activated by the time of the pandemic to prioritize what is really God saying to them about engaging this time.
So, Mr. Mafale, we are still in the time of pandemic. Level one is it May, you know, we are still in the time of the COVID-19 pandemic. So from today, right, what can the church do? And as you were rightfully pointing out, the church is you and I. What are some of the practical steps or whatever that we can take from now?
I'm just going to say what is really a big emphasis in my heart. Like I said, a time of a pandemic usually empowers the believer. So one of the big issues that must be taken advantage of is that I need to make leaders in their homes resource to resource their own homes. Meaning you can't go as parents or as a dad or a mom in a home. You need to really pastor your home. I'm talking about a father beginning to minister the word of God in his own home, like a leader would on a Sunday morning in church. So that's one of the things for me that has become a big deal in my home. Problem number two is the issue of leadership. We need to sharpen leaders. There needs to be a new emphasis on how leaders are trained, how they administer their environments, how do they deal with the fact that some of their systems that they had built before the epidemic failed. How do they reconcile with that probably the way I was allowing my believers to partner with the work of ministry wasn't proper. That's why probably we suffered a financial crisis, because they were not attending meetings. The idea that meetings are the inspire for offering must be confronted seriously. I must be able to actually partner with the work of God, either I'm in a meeting or not.
Yeah. Oh, geez, I'm schooled. This has been absolutely amazing. It is one of those things. Thank you so much, Mr. Mafa. This has been wonderful. And Mr. Kwaza, we missed you. we missed you, but geez, was this packed, you know? Yeah. So thank you. Thank you so much, Mr. Mafa. This has been absolutely incredible. It's amazing. And I really hope and trust that every single believer, knowing that we are the church, you know, is going to go out from today and really live life differently and partner. Thank you to you too, Etewini, every time. This has been our conversation with Mr. Andile Mafa, Mr. Wa Mafa. It's been absolutely so amazing. And if you're unsafe, maybe it is time that you take Jesus as your Lord and Savior and really do find a church and be the church rather. And thank you so much, Etewini, for joining us. us. This has been absolutely amazing. I would like to thank Mashwebe Center once again for hosting us today. And I'd love to thank Udu Confidence Designs and Isimo Daily Creations and all our other sponsors. It's really been absolutely amazing. So I love you so much, but remember, God loves you more. Cheers. Bye.
Bye.